Father, we thank you for your great grace to us. Thank you for John's description of your Son, our Savior, that of his fullness we have all received, and grace upon grace. We thank you for the constancy of your grace toward us. The first two chapters set the stage for the rest of the book. They introduce it in two ways. They both begin in the same way, after the death of Joshua, just to give us the timing. So chapter 1, verse 1, after the death of Joshua. And then we have the history of that period in terms of the tribes and how the tribes both succeeded and failed to complete the conquest. Joshua had taken them through the land of Canaan. They had conquered, first of all, down to the south and then up to the north, taken all the major areas. Now, and then the land was portioned out, so they lived in different parts of it. And now they are to go back and they are to take control of the area that's been given to them and to pacify the places that had not really been brought under their control. So that's chapter 1 and the first 5 verses of chapter 2. And it's a story of increasing failure. Now, chapter 2, verse 6 to chapter 3, verse 6, and with chapter 3, verse 7, we're getting into the history of the judges themselves. Chapter 3, verse 6 is the same history, the same period of time, but this time from God's point of view. And we're going to see it as God sees it and to see what is going on that particular occasion. So there's really 3 parts to the passage, and we're going to look at them tonight. First of all, in verses 6 to 10, we have the contrast that really sets before here. Joshua, a man of faith. The leaders who were leaders under Joshua, they're the next generation down, because Caleb and Joshua are the only, they're both over 80. They are, at this particular point, alone in that generation, and the next group is considerably younger than they are. And so I guess the oldest of them would be 40 or so. Those leaders do well, but here's the contrast. When Joshua dismissed the people of Israel went each to his inheritance to take possession of the land. And the people served Yahweh all the days of Joshua, all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that Yahweh had done for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of Yahweh, died at the age of 110 years. And they buried him within the boundaries of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountains of Gaash. And all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. Slash, but, change, and there arose another generation after them who did not know Yahweh or the work that he had done for Israel. Now that's going to be, in effect, the story of what we're going to see unfolding in the next section. It's looked at in more detail, and the third section kind of completes that whole process. Now, when I wrote the book on Judges, and by the way, Les is saying that he has had some, and I think some of you picked up a copy of that book. We're not going to try and, I don't have that many new insights from what I wrote, but I'm not just sort of rereading that. And I think they're going to be getting more in, so you can get the details from him about Hearts of Iron, Feet of Clay. I call this the second generation syndrome, and we'll see how that fits. The second generation, or you could call it the third generation, however you want to do it. I called it, for our sakes, the law of spiritual entropy. So the second law of thermodynamics is what? The idea that when energy decreases, entropy increases. Things go from a position of potential energy to actual energy to entropy. The entropy is dissipated. and it doesn't get returned. So you've got water on top of a hill. It goes down to the bottom of the hill. It's not going back up the hill again unless energy is brought in from outside. You've got hot water. It becomes cold. Unless energy is brought in from outside, it's not going to get warmer. There's this downhill drift. And it's interesting that in the context here, there is a kind of spiritual entropy that takes place. God's glory is displayed. God's works are displayed. God's goodness are displayed. The people see those and receive them. But because they don't respond, if we can put it that way, with their own energy, entropy just keeps increasing. And unless grace is brought in from outside, they'll stay stuck in that condition. That they demonstrate that God's grace, once poured out, doesn't ultimately change their condition. There needs to be a constant dependence on it, and we'll see that working itself out through here. So first of all, I want you to notice, and it's pretty evident, the contrast. Now, it's rather striking what has happened. I think I pointed this out 2 weeks ago that I know that you've forgotten in the interim, because I sort of had. Verse 6 is really a quotation from the book of Joshua. And if you were to take your Bibles and just turn back the page, you'll notice that verse 28 of the last chapter of Joshua begins, "So Joshua sent the people away, every man to his own inheritance." Well, that's verse 6 of chapter 2. And then it has an interim verse. "The people served Yahweh all the days of Joshua, all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who'd seen all the great work that Yahweh had done for Israel." And then we're back to Joshua again, verse 29. "After these things, Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of Yahweh, died, being 110 years old, and they buried him." And it says in verse 31, "Israel served Yahweh all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua and had known all the work that the Lord did for Israel." Now, it may be the same writer between Joshua and Judges. That's entirely probable. It may be that he knows the book of Joshua and that he is doing it. But at this particular point, he is picking up the end point of the book to make this point, that under Joshua, a man of faith, God's people acted in faith and realized what God had promised. They went into the land, they conquered the land, and they brought it as a whole, and it's important to understand, as a whole, they brought it under their control. They're now the dominant people within the land. There are outposts of Canaanites and tribes, and we're going to see that as we go into this next section. Now, let's think a little bit about Joshua, just to remind ourselves about him. Anybody tell me, when the first time Joshua appears in the Old Testament story? Moses? Well, obviously related to Moses, but well, it's actually an interesting story. And if you think of Moses with his hands lifted up, you remember that in Exodus, is it 17? I'm not sure right now. They end up in battle against one of the desert tribes. Joshua leads the tribes, the Israelites, into battle, while Moses, with Aaron and Hur, are up on the mountain, and Moses is watching and he is praying. But Joshua, even though he's a young man at this particular time, is still a skilled general, significant enough to be trusted by Moses to lead Israel's armies into battle. So that's the first time he appears. The second time he appears is with Moses in Exodus chapter 24, going up to the mountain. And he spends time on the mountain with Moses and the Lord. Whether it's the same occasion or not, You'll remember a little bit later in Exodus chapter 32, Moses is up on the mountain. He is there with the Lord, and we've discovered Joshua is with him again. So probably on two different occasions at least, he's on the mountain with Joshua. This time they're coming back, and Joshua hears a lot of noise. And in response to saying, what party is going on? Moses says, no, it's the people in rebellion against God, and he smashes the tablet. Now, it's interesting, in that particular context, it describes Joshua as, let me read it in chapter, this is actually in the next part of the story. Moses builds a little tent, or pitches a little tent outside. Remember, his face was glowing when he came down, and they made him cover it up, and he pitched a tent, and he would meet with the Lord in that tent before the Holy of Holies is set up. And it says, when Moses turned again into the camp, his assistant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, would not depart from the tent. And he's called the assistant of Moses again in Numbers chapter 11. So he was apparently an apprentice, or his chief aide. Call him what you will. There was a long-term relationship with them. And then the next time he appears is in the great significant turning point, which is the spies going into the land. He's one of the 12 spies that goes into the land, and he and Caleb make their stand for the Lord alongside Moses, even though the people are threatening to kill them all. And on that occasion, the Lord says, in effect, you're all going to die in the wilderness. Only Caleb and Joshua are going to go in, and Moses is told he's not going to go in as well. Then the next stage of his life is that God commands Moses to appoint Joshua as his successor. Moses is very conflicted about that, because he still wants to go into the land, and he has trouble accepting that what God said is no. But he is commissioned directly by the Lord that he is to be the leader. He is given the gift of the Holy Spirit to be the leader, and the book of Joshua begins with God himself appearing to Joshua after he died. And the statement that is made, it's made in the book of Deuteronomy as he's appointed the first time. It's made when he comes back, and it's when God comes to him in Joshua chapter 1, be strong and very courageous, for I am with you wherever you go. So Joshua was clearly a man who knew God, who had an experience, a history of faithfulness and obedience to the Lord. And he takes the lead, we're told in this, and not only does he take the lead, but he also makes an impact on those who are with him. So the people served Yahweh all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who'd seen all the great work that Yahweh had done for Israel. That's the faithful generation. And then we come to verse 10. And there arose another generation after them who did not know Yahweh or the work that he had done for Israel. And on one level, we read that, and that seems puzzling to us. What does it mean? They didn't know Yahweh. They certainly knew about him. And it says they didn't know the work he'd done for Israel. Well, they'd been part of the conquest. They crossed the Jordan. They walked around Jericho with everybody else in one sense. So the word know can't mean they didn't have intellectual knowledge of it. It must mean in some way, and this is what some scholars say, it means they didn't acknowledge it in the sense that it was crucial. They didn't acknowledge the Lord. They didn't have respect and regard for Yahweh. They were surrounded by what had been done. They had heard the stories from their parents and from Joshua of both the Exodus and the conquest and all of that, and yet still surrounded by all of that spiritual knowledge, they forgot. They suffered from spiritual amnesia. Now, I want you to take your Bibles just for a minute and turn with me to look at a few verses, because the striking thing is this is precisely what Moses warned them against. So turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Now, he's speaking to the people just before they go into the conquest, and he's talking about their need to obey him and do all of these other things because of what they've experienced. But notice verse 9. Only take care and keep your soul diligently, lest you forget the things that your eyes have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children. And then he goes on to say more related to that. Verse 23. He says, take care, lest you forget the covenant of Yahweh your God, which he made with you, and you make a carved image, the form of anything that Yahweh your God has forgiven you. Or turn with me to chapter 6. And this is the famous chapter that's, Hear, O Israel, Yahweh is our God, Yahweh alone. You shall love Yahweh your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And then he goes on to say, verse 10, when Yahweh your God brings you into the land that he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to give you, with great and good cities you didn't build, and houses full of good things that you didn't fill, and cisterns that you didn't dig, and vineyards and olive trees that you didn't plant, and when you eat and are full, then take care lest you forget the Lord, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. And if that's not enough, turn to chapter 8. Verse 1, the whole command that I command you today, you shall be careful to do, lest you live and multiply and go in and possess the land that Yahweh swore to your fathers, swore to give to your fathers, and you shall remember the whole way that Yahweh your God has led you these 40 years, that he may humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments. Verse 11, take care lest you forget Yahweh your God. Verse 14, then your heart is lifted up and you forget Yahweh your God. Verse 18, you shall remember Yahweh your God. It is he who gave you power to get wealth, that he may confirm his covenant that he swore to your fathers, as is this day. And if you forget Yahweh your God and go after other gods and serve them and worship them, I solemnly warn you today, you will surely perish. Interesting how often that's said, and there's more places that we could go to in the book of Deuteronomy. The danger is that they will forget what God has done, and they did. They didn't know the Lord in the sense of it. They were in the context of what had happened, but they hadn't made it their own. They hadn't appropriated it by faith. They knew about Yahweh. They didn't know Yahweh. And when you hear that repeated so often in that one, it's impossible not to think of Jesus on the night he was betrayed saying, keep doing this in remembrance of me. I think that's some of the root out of this, because God's people forget what God has done unless they purpose to remember and deliberately remember and set it on their minds and hearts. And that's what the Lord's table is intended to do, is to keep this fresh, is to keep it before us so that we don't lose track of what God has done for us along the way. Anything that we should notice out of what I've mentioned so far. I'm sorry?
Just how quickly.
Yeah, I mean, this is, we're not talking 100 years. We're talking about the next generation. And I've mentioned it before. You've heard me mention it. It's very easy to think of institutions in this country that were started by devout Christians, and all they have is the name attached to them. It's easy to think of great churches that were built and were once full and were, and if we don't remember. And the issue isn't, as someone else has said, the issue is not so much that we actually forget, is that we begin to just assume that to be true and turn our attention to other things. And first things don't stay first. And we forget the central things, and then they become less and less significant until they're submerged by all kinds of other things. Elizabeth.
I can't remember the chapter, but even when you get to the end of Deuteronomy, doesn't Moses say, okay, I'm going to die, and as soon as I took my last breath, you guys are going to be rushing away from things that I tried to teach you. I mean, they just didn't ever get it.
Now, and of course, Joshua, in his last speech to the people, ends by saying, I've served the Lord for all these years, but you choose today whom you will serve. It's a choice that you must make for yourself. And it's a great reminder to us as parents that we and grandparents that we can't take for granted that our kids can, just because they're surrounded by spiritual things, that they've grabbed hold of spiritual things on their own. Okay, so now, looking at verse 10. I'm sorry, I'm in Deuteronomy in my Bible. In verse 10, it says, there arose another generation after them who did not know Yahweh or the work that he had done for Israel. So now from verse 11 to verse 19, we are going to have described the cycle that is the cycle of the book of Judges. And on one level, it's a cycle, it's a circle, but it is going to follow this same pattern. There is going to be sin. And we'll see that in this passage in verses 11 to 13. And then, because God's anger, they are sent into, or they don't, they're not sent, they are invaded. And the term that's used in this passage is plunderers will come in. So they've got these evading hordes that are going to come in and dominate them so that they are put under servitude. The way it is in this next passage is then Yahweh, out of his grace, sees the condition they're in and he sends a judge to save them, to deliver them. And so the pattern of sin, servitude, salvation. Now, in many of the places, not mentioned in this chapter, actually supplication is not a really good word, but it began with S, and the others all start with S, so I had to find one. But there'll be a cry. But it's not a cry of repentance, it's a cry of pain and distress. They're crying out to God in desperation, not in repentance. But many times there is this supplication that we'll see. But then, when they are restored and the judge comes, there is sin again. Only it's worse sin. So what we have isn't a cycle, it's a spiral. Going around the same things, but going lower and lower six times over in the book for the judges. And we'll see this pattern each time in the book. Sin, and we'll look at that in just a minute about what that's involved, because it always involves the same thing. Servitude, the anger of the Lord was kindled. They provoked the Lord. Salvation, God in mercy does for them what they do not deserve and sends in a deliverer. He delivers. but then they are back into sin again. Their hearts are not changed simply by the intervention of God and his actions on their behalf. So let's just follow that through. Let me read through the passage, then we'll come back and notice it. So verse 11, "And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of Yahweh and served the Baals. They abandoned Yahweh, the God of their fathers, who brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were around them. They bowed down to them. They provoked Yahweh to anger. They abandoned Yahweh, served the Baals and Ashtaroth. So the anger of Yahweh was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them, and he sold them into the hands of their surrounding enemies, so they could no longer withstand their enemies. Whenever they marched out, the hand of Yahweh was against them for harm, as Yahweh had warned, and as Yahweh had sworn to them, and they were in terrible distress. Then Yahweh raised up judges who saved them out of the hand of those who plundered them. They didn't listen to their judges, for they whored after other gods and bowed down to them. They soon turned aside from the way in which their fathers had walked, who had obeyed the commandments of Yahweh, and they did not do so. Whenever Yahweh raised up judges for them, Yahweh was with the judge, and he saved them from the hand of their enemies all the days of the judge. For Yahweh was moved to pity by their groaning because of those who afflicted and oppressed them. But whenever the judge died, they turned back and were more corrupt than their forefathers, going after other gods, serving them, and bowing down to them. They did not drop any of their practices or their stubborn ways." So, whatever you have, and however you would call this, there is a reprieve. But there's no revival in terms of renewal of their heart and something that happens more permanently. So let's go back. The first part of this cycle then is sin. And in verses 11 to 13, we have it described. Verse 11 says something a little more strongly than the way it's translated in the ESV. "The people of Israel did what was the evil in the sight of Yahweh." It wasn't just evil. It was the evil in the sight of Yahweh. And that is idolatry. And departing from him to worship other gods. It is the evil because the very center of the covenant was loyalty to Yahweh. "The first two commandments, you shall have no other gods before me, and you shall not make any idols." But that's what they turned to. So let's just notice chapter 3 and verse 7. "And the people of Israel did what was the evil in the sight of Yahweh. They forgot Yahweh and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth." So Othniel comes along, and he is the judge, and they have 40 good years, as verse 11 says. Then verse 12, "And the people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of Yahweh." And bondage occurs. Chapter 4, verse 1. "The people of Israel again did what was the evil in the sight of Yahweh," after Ehud died. And the Lord sends them off into other people. Chapter 6, verse 1. "The people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of Yahweh. And Yahweh gave them into the hand of Midian for 7 years. Chapter 10 and verse 6, I think. "The people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of Yahweh and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth," and so forth. And then chapter 13 and verse 1. "And the people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of Yahweh." Now remember what the last verse of this entire book says. If you don't remember, look it up, just quickly. Judges chapter 21, verse 25. I'll give you a clue. "There was no king in Israel. They did what was right in their own eyes." They did what was evil in the sight of Yahweh. They did what was right in their own eyes. It's not hard to look at the United States and hear people calling evil good and the right thing and the appropriate thing to do. But it's an interesting thing. So you see, that pretty clear, isn't it, as I read through that passage. Every time a new judge is going to come, it's because there's been doing the evil in the sight of Yahweh. Now, the evil is defined in this passage as they served the Baals, and then they abandoned Yahweh, the God of their fathers, who brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were around them. They bowed down to them. They provoked Yahweh to anger. They abandoned Yahweh. They served the Baals and the Ashtaroth. So he's piling up. There's five different terms to describe what they did in terms of their rebellion against God. But let me just notice, they served the Baals and the Ashtaroth. Those were Canaanite gods. The Canaanites had lots of gods, but Baal was the most popular. He was the son of El. El was the mighty god. And Baal was the storm god. As the storm god, he controlled rain. So, in effect, he controls the fertility of the land. And so he is the god who he has all kinds of local manifestations. When it says they serve the Baals, you'll notice the plural, because there's all kinds of other gods. Baal was just the big one, but there were also local gods. You had Baal here, or Baal here, Baal of the hills, Baal Ash, of this place, Baal of the valley, Baal of the, and so forth. So you had local manifestations, your local Baal that you needed to serve. And the idea is by serving him, you would show him what to do. I need to be careful in describing this. But then the other term that's used is Asherah or Astarte. She is a female goddess. And she was depicted as having enlarged parts of her features on poles and was worshipped in that particular way. And she was the fertility goddess. So at the basis of this, you worship the storm god, or you did acts before the storm god. And the whole point of the worship, when it talks about they prostituted themselves after the Baals, as is used here, that's spiritually true, because they were being unfaithful to Yahweh. But it was also physically true, because at the local temples, there were sacred prostitutes, and you engaged in imitative worship. In other words, you wanted fertility in the soil, so you did what brings human fertility with one of the prostitutes. Now, with that kind of religion and that kind of evangelism, it appeals to something very basic in human drives and desires. It sanctified lust, is what it was. And so it had a hold on people in a particular way. Totally different from, I mean, you went to the temple, you pleasured yourself, you did all of this. This was worshiping the god, in contrast to a god who was invisible and not seeable in terms of any tangible form. And you had a little idol and you served the idol and did all of those kind of things. And that will be with Israel as its prevailing thing. And you know, we know the story of Elijah. And the story of Elijah is 600 years after this, just to give some idea of how all this Baal worship is going to hold on. It will still be present. And the Baals will be a big problem up until the time they're taken away in the Babylonian captivity. And the Babylonian captivity will, as it were, drive idolatry out of Israel in large measure. But it won't drive sin. It'll just take a different form. But idolatry wasn't there. So that was the constant pull toward what was visible and invisible. I remember one of the trips we made to Greece, And I remember we had our bus driver, it was actually the guide, and it was a woman, and she would say, now over there, and she would say, that's, and she would give the Greek Orthodox name for that place. But then she would say, but you know, our ancestors, they worshipped such and such a goddess there. And they would go through all of these different places. And what there were shrines to saints and other religious figures. But really, it was just a thin cover for the paganism that still was there. And, of course, you've got it in South America all the way through. You've got the Christo-paganism, which is very much a thin veneer of this. So this isn't something that's not present in other ways in our world today. So that was the sin that is involved, and it's described in pretty graphic terms. The phrase at the end of verse 12, they provoked Yahweh to anger. It's almost, when I hear that, I think they kept sticking a stick in Yahweh's eyes, as it were, you know, poking them every time they engaged in this. It was just poking away. And so then we read in verse 14, so the anger of Yahweh was kindled against Israel. So this is the second one, servitude. And he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them. And he sold them into the hand of their surrounding enemies. Now think of the irony of that. He sold them into the hand of their surrounding enemies. What's the theological word for God bringing his people out of Egypt? What did he do? Actually, there's a certain church that he redeemed them. What does redeemed mean? To buy out from slavery. And the irony is the God who bought his people out is now selling them into the hands of plunderers. It's a very graphic description of, but it's because they become addicted to their sin. And the cycle needs to be broken by God's intervention. So his righteous anger, they've provoked him. The anger of Yahweh is kindled. And then it says what happened. They couldn't withstand their enemies, so they couldn't stop them when they came in. And when they went out in battle against them, the hand of Yahweh was against them for harm. Strong. As Yahweh had warned. And as Yahweh had sworn to them, and they were in terrible distress. So for 114 years during the book of Judges, they will be in terrible distress. If you capture all of the various times in which they are under the control of plunderers in that particular way. And then we have the third part of the cycle. Then Yahweh raised up judges who saved them out of the hand of those who plundered them. Verse 18, whenever Yahweh raised up judges for them, Yahweh was with the judge, and he saved them from the hand of their enemies all the days of the judge. For Yahweh was moved to pity by their groaning because of those who'd afflicted and oppressed them. So there's several things that are evident here. First of all, it is entirely the initiative of God in his grace to act in compassion toward people who do not deserve his compassion. And yet, for the sake of the fact that they are his people, they are under covenant relationship to him, he still intervenes, he still owns them as his own people, and he sends these people in to deliver them. Now, we talked in the very first session about these judges. They're not judges as we think of judges. They are military leaders, relatively local guys who will gather around the military figures of different size. They are in certain ways empowered by the Spirit, but they are not going to be a very impressive group, most of them. We start with Othniel, and we start pretty well, but we're going to end with Samson. And Samson is not who you want your child to turn out to be like. I mean, he was not a moral character in any kind of way, and yet God was using him, which only tells you how corrupt almost everything else is. And that's where, in the midst of all of this, you need to think of all of this is going on, and then you come to the book of Ruth, as Elizabeth had you looking at it last week. And it's almost as if this is a whole different thing, that there still are God's true and faith, there's still a Boaz who will act in a righteous way in the midst of this, and there's still a Ruth who will leave her people to come to be with, because there's enough of God still there that they will see that. But God allows them to be overrun by these six different groups that are going to overrun them. And most of them come from outside, not from within, not the Canaanites, except the Philistines are nearby. So what else do we need to look at here? So that leads us to the last one. Well, it really begins in verse 17. They didn't listen to their judges. Now, most of the time, the judges were not preachers, and they weren't godly people. The first few were. But the point is, they prostituted themselves after other gods and bowed down to them. They soon turned away from the ways. So after the judge comes, there'll be a respite for a while, but then they'll go back to use the language of Peter. The dog will return to its own vomit. Go back to the to that which ought to repel them. And you'll notice in verse 19, they turned back and were more corrupt than their fathers, going after other gods, serving them and bowing down to them. And they didn't drop any of their practices or their stubborn ways. So we've got this spiral. We'll go around it six times, and we'll end at the bottom. And if we keep reading at the bottom, and we go right through the book of Judges, who's the next group we come to? Where does 1 Samuel begin? Who's the major leader in of God's people in the beginning of the book of Samuel? Eli, the priest, right? Eli the priest. And what are Hophni and Phinehas doing at the tabernacle? They're so that when Eli dies and there's any thought that Hophni and Phinehas are going to take over, God breaks their necks, quite literally, and so forth. So I just want you to see how this spiral is going to go all the way down, and it's going to go all the way down till Saul looks like a breath of fresh air. It appears to be at first, but then he goes down a similar spiral until God brings David. And David, with all his faults, is still a man after God's own heart, and a man who cares about spiritual things. Ultimately, of course, all of that is going to bring about the Savior, but this is the time of the judges. I'll make you sleep well tonight knowing that this is the course of the book. But okay, let's just pause here. Any things that we should pick up as we think about this spiral? Any observations you want to make? Nikki?
Sorry, I'm not
here. Connor's not here, so Elizabeth's taking over.
I'm actually just curious. You mentioned that God raises leaders, but they weren't necessarily good. Or did you mean, you didn't say good, but they weren't. Were they not believers themselves?
Well, it's an interesting thing, because you turn to the book of Hebrews, and it says, by faith, And it talks about
Samson. I know. I wouldn't have put him in that list.
No, I wouldn't have put him there either. And Ehud, Gideon starts well, and we name a Bible distribution thing after him, but he talks out of two sides of his mouth. And these are not the kind of, not the person that you want to have coming recommended by the nominating committee of the church for on Sunday. I mean, he's just.
Okay, so he just does it for them.
These are God's, the other one, Jephthah, he's a bandit leader that God uses. So
things are bad.
Right? Sorry?
So things are really bad in those times.
In the middle of Judges 2:14, it says that the enemy surrounded them. Who are the enemies?
Well, as we go through Ryan, there's going to be a bunch of different ones. So some of them are going to be, for example, you have the Midianites that are going to come off the desert. You have the Moabites that are going to come across into what's Jordan. You're going to have the Syrians who come down from Syria, Cushan Rishathaim. So he's going to come from the north. You have the Philistines who are out on the coast, and they're going to come up from the south. So there's a group of different ones. As a matter of fact, we'll find some of them named a little bit later in what we're going to look at. But there's a bunch of them. Then they've got internally the various Canaanite tribes, the Hebusites and the Jebusites and so forth. So. Okay, so now we're at the consequences stage. And it's kind of interesting to see what now is said in verse 20. The Lord is using the nations, and he's using them rather surprisingly for two purposes at the same time. The first one is in verses 20 to 23. So the anger of Yahweh was kindled against Israel. So that's repeated. We had that earlier up in verse 14. And he said, because this people have transgressed my covenant, that's the central thing, that I commanded their fathers and have not obeyed my voice, I will no longer drive out before them any of the nations that Joshua left when he died. I'm not going to look after their enemies for them. In order to test Israel by them, whether they will take care to walk in the way of Yahweh as their fathers did or not. So Yahweh left those nations, not driving them out quickly, and he did not give them into the hand of Joshua. So even as early, the Lord, knowing what was going on, he didn't allow them to have complete victory at the beginning because he knew they were going to disobey. And he's left these areas to test them, but also to punish them. But then there's an interesting shift in chapter 3 and verse 1. Now, these are the nations that Yahweh left to test Israel by them. That is, all in Israel who had not experienced all the wars in Canaan. It was only in order that the generations of the people of Israel might know war, to teach war to those who had not known it before. These are the nations, the five lords of the Philistines. They had the Pentapolis, five cities. All the Canaanites, the Sidonians, that's up on the coast, the Phoenicia, the Hivites who lived on Mount Lebanon, so that's up north, from Baal Hermon, that's to the north again, Mount Hermon, as far as Lebo Hamath. They were for the testing of Israel, to know whether Israel would obey the commandments of Yahweh, which he commanded their fathers by the hands of Moses. Now, I find this intriguing in a specific way. On one level, God was leaving them there to punish them and to test whether they would turn and obey. The other thing he was doing was leaving them there to deliberately force them to learn war. And all I can think of is that means that God left these people to teach Israel their own weakness and their own dependence upon God. If he'd removed all of the issues in their life, they would not have needed to learn to trust him. If Joshua had conquered it completely, they could have sat back and said, it's just fine. But God deliberately left areas that were uncompleted to teach them how to fight. That's a curious thing. And yet, as I think about my own life, I'll never forget, when I was a college kid, I went to a Word of Life camp in New York State, and I was a counselor there for the summer. And I'd had a lot of college ministry and so forth, so even though I was, how old was I? I guess that was the year I was 20. So I got back there, and I got late for a week after all the training had taken place and got thrown right in, and they said, you know, we're just short with people who are counseling. You said you had some experience with older people, so we're going to have you counseling people from 20 to 35. And yeah, you've got to be kidding. Anyway, the very first week I'm there, they gave me two guys who had come to Christ. They were right out of New York City, out of a very rough part of New York City. And they'd both been heroin addicts, and they'd been in jail a number of times, and different things had happened, and some tough but godly woman had got a hold of them and got the gospel into them and pounded them. And they'd quit their heroin use, and they were hardline addicts, cold turkey. And yet they weren't welcome in any of their family's home because they'd stolen everything, you know, just that, these kind of guys. They weren't the kind of guys I grew up with in my neighborhood. There were very few of them in InterVarsity Christian Fellowship who were like this. I was way out of my depth. But so they'd relapsed. Marty had relapsed. And so he came up, and he was, again, kicking heroin. Well, he hadn't been on it very much at this point. Cold turkey. And I was responsible. He was my counselor. But he got past that, and he was there for a while, and we spent a lot of time together. They had an interesting rule at this camp. You couldn't smoke at the camp, obviously. They said, oh, you can if you swim out 50 yards, and you can light up there. Except if you were really addicted, you could smoke if you went off with a counselor. It was one of the most brilliant things I've ever seen a camp do, because Marty wanted to smoke, and he could only smoke if I was with him. And that gave me 20 minutes to half an hour, just there, several times a day to do this. But I can remember, he said, you know, I don't understand. God took away heroin, even though I fell back, God took that away. He's made me free of that. Why doesn't he take away smoking? I mean, he did the big thing for me. Why didn't he take away why didn't he just remove it all? And it was an interesting question to ponder. And all I could think of was to say, Marty, I think he didn't take it away so you would know you still need to depend upon him. And he was trying to quit. And I thought, you know, that's probably true in my life, too. There's areas in my life that the Lord has just left as problem areas. And he's made me still dependent. I've got to learn more. I can't just... All of us know. I mean, we're already God's people, but we're not yet what we're going to be. And there's all kinds of Canaanites who still live in our life. Some of us more than others. And God's strategy, in some sense, seems to... I mean, he could save us and sanctify us entirely, immediately. But would we feel a need for him at that stage in the same way? Or would we think, I'm okay now. I can, you know, thanks for the help, Lord, and move off on our own. So there's something here about he left these to teach them how to fight. And I think God does some of those things in our lives as well. And As you get older, maybe some of the things you fight change a little bit, but there's always something more to fight. God's not finished with us and won't be this side of heaven. I don't know. You can do with that what you want. The last verse, verse 5 and verse 6. So the people of Israel lived among the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites. And their daughters they took to themselves for wives. And their own daughters they gave to them as sons. And they served their gods. You've heard me quote Alexander Pope before. Vice is a creature of such frightful mien as to be hated needs but to be seen. But seen too oft, grown familiar with its face, we first abhor, then pity, then embrace. And that happens. It's happening in our culture. There were things that were utterly unthinkable not very long ago. Things that would not be on television by any broadcast media would not be allowed. And now they're accepted as the norm. And now new things are being pushed onto us. And there's this. And slowly we become Canaanized. It doesn't happen very often. And you find people adjusting their theology to accommodate because in the individual of the United States, you want to go along so you can get ahead. And you, so that's the big issue, quite frankly, related to the LGBT stuff. It isn't what it is in itself. I mean, for goodness sake, transgender people are less than 0.1% of the population. But the agenda that's behind it, and I'm going to speak a little bit on this a week Sunday, but and we need to treat people who are as confused as Bruce Jenner is with compassion. He needs pity. He doesn't need surgery. And he needs love and compassion. But there's all kinds of people who are using the Bruce Jenners, who's still Mr. Jenner, even if he wants to be called Caitlin, who are using him for a larger agenda to move away from a biblical worldview and the sense of, I'm not the master of my fate. I don't get to choose my sexual activity on the basis of my preference. I'm accountable to a holy God. But Canaanite worship doesn't have a problem with that. Because if you don't like this God, find this one. You can always find a God who will please your preference. It's only Yahweh who says, no. You come my way. There is no other way. Well, that got a little preachy, but that's okay. Any things that we should observe, note, comment on? Less. Let me get this on.
Going back to a statement you made earlier about a book that I found in the store called Hearts of Iron and Feet of Clay by renowned author Gary Inrig. I ran out of copies tonight, but if you want one, please raise your hand. It doesn't make you committed to it, but at least I need to know how to order it. It's this outstanding commentary on the market that Gary wrote a few years ago. And if you can't take notes fast enough, my wife says you can take the notes and put the answers in there. So if you're interested in a copy, raise your hand a minute. Get one, two. Okay. I'll try to have a few in a week or so.
And after that, word from our sponsor, is there any other? and we're very appreciative, Les, of your kindness to us here.
Yeah. I have a question. I know in the New Testament we learn about God as our Father when we're born again and adopted as his children. Is there anywhere in the Old Testament where he's referred to as the Father of Israel? Because this seems so fatherly to me, the way that he protects them and cares for them, but then he also disciplines them.
There's not a lot of places in the Old Testament, but and I can't, but he's talked about as a father, and it uses in Isaiah, we'll use that language. He'll also talk about God in motherly terms as the one who gathers them. So it does occur. The term more commonly is shepherd for, to describe the care and the concern, but also the rod and the staff to deal with the sheep. So in the Old Testament, there's no illustration of an individual talking about God as Father, but there are several places where our Father is used to speak about him. But that's especially the Christian way of thinking about God. So
it's the name that's different, but the relationship is the same.
Relationship is similar, but the fullness of it, it's revealed in Christ. I mean, that's the essence of it.
That just brought up another question. Jesus says that no one can come to the Father, or he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. By Jesus' time was referring to God, maybe not as my Father, but as the Father. Was that common and understood?
No, it
was as a way to refer to God? No.
If you remember John 5, it says, he says to them after he's cured the man at the pool of Bethesda, why did you do this? They challenged him. He said, my Father is working. It was a Sabbath day. My Father is working until now, and I'm working. And it says in the text, they took up stones to stone him because he called God his own Father, making himself equal with God. To them, it was unthinkable that an individual would speak of God as Father. So I have to understand, by the first century, the sense of distancing themselves from God was even becoming more strong. So, and you have it in Judaism today, that if a Jewish person who is at all devout speaks the name or writes the name of God, they will not write the name of God. They will write G-D, because they don't want in any way to use that. So when they come and they're thinking about, I'm going to write it in Hebrew here, they will speak about God as Ha, which means the Shem, the name. And they will avoid using the name of God because that's too sacred, too personal. So when Jesus comes in talking about he's my Father, and when he teaches disciples to pray, Father, and when the Spirit comes saying, Abba, Father, all of that is just astonishing to them. But it's why, in some way, it's so important to Christians to learn to pray Father and not just God. Because he's given us the privilege of calling him. Not even by, and the Jews would not pronounce the name Yahweh. That's why it wasn't clear how it was going to be pronounced. And at a later time in Jewish history, when the Masoretes were writing, and they were, the Jews, every time the name Yahweh would come, they would replace it with Adonai, because Yahweh was the personal name of God. Adonai means my Lord, my Master. And even when they wrote the name, they were so wanting people not to pronounce it that they put in the vowels, they're just little, of the name Adonai to the consonants for Yahweh, and out of that came Jehovah. And Jehovah is gibberish. It's come to have some meaning for us, but it's gibberish, Hebrew. Nothing ever was said that way. It's not God's Hebrew name. Anyway. That was a long digression. Does that answer sort of what you're asking?
I have a few friends who have gone from Adventism to Messianic Jew, mm-hmm. and they write God like this.
Messianic Judaism.
Messianic Judaism, yeah, mm-hmm. sorry. And they write God like that, G right. with a... Why? I mean, if they accept Jesus as the Messiah, why do they not see that...
Because they bought into the concept that Judaism is the same as biblical Hebrewism, if I can put it that way. And, I mean, there's nothing wrong with putting that, but that's not Christian. Christian is God has brought us into his family and allowed us to call him by name. So all they've got is bought a tradition. And there's a lot of that in Messianic Judaism, the prayer shawls and all of these other things.
So they're
not even Old Testament shadows. They're strictly Jewish shadows.
It confuses me. I mean, so they're not necessarily born again then? Because
obviously that's an issue. You can be confused about certain things and mistaught about certain things. If you're trusting in Christ as your Lord and Savior, believing he's God the Son who paid the price for you on the cross, you can be confused about how you should write God because you've been...
I agree. Okay.
Taught that. So I'm not going to make a judgment on their eternal salvation, but they are spiritually confused. Now, there's a proper, I think, Messianic Judaism, but trying to just take over without thought many of those things. I won't get into my pet peeve, but even the way in our Bibles, we have the Lord in capital letters rather than Yahweh as the name of God, I think is unfortunate. He gave us his name so we could call it, and we shouldn't be more devout than the Bible. Sorry, I'm getting onto my pet peeves here. So, okay, I think I need to stop for your sake. So next week we get into the first judges, into Othniel and Ehud, and Connor will be back, so we'll do Shamgar for Connor's sake. I was very concerned about that a couple of weeks ago, that Shamgar wasn't get properly taken care of. So, Father, thank you for the amazing reminder to us that there's none that does good, no, not one, and on the basis of either our own merit or our ancestry, we have no claim upon you whatsoever. But you are faithful to yourself, and you're faithful to your promises, and you did not cast away your people. But through them, even in this sinfulness, you were working to bring the Redeemer into our world. We thank you for him. But also teach us from this that we cannot play with holy things, that you are a holy God, as well as being an almighty, gracious God. Thank you for the truth of your word in Christ's name. Amen.